Hey guys, and welcome to another episode of Digital Classroom. We did restart the stream because YouTube didn't catch up, and sometimes that happens, and then normally when you switch over the stream, it works. So there we have YouTube, and let's see if we also can get Twitch to, that's Twitch, and there we have YouTube. Okay, so all streams are now working. That's awesome. So today, Digital Classroom, and today it's all about the mobile workflow. We did switch some things over because last time we had a lot of delays and other stuff going on that wasn't really nice. So, Anouye, can I close YouTube now here? You have the chat?
Yeah, I have the chat.
Okay, Anouye has the chat for YouTube, so I'm going to switch over to only Twitch. Okay, so we are streaming on two platforms, Twitch and YouTube. Both are about similar to what you see, of course, it's a live stream. But the cool thing is with Twitch, in the future, we have some other things that we can do that is going to be interesting. And today we are actually going to test something a little bit more interactive. So it's going to be fun. And today it's all about the mobile workflow. So let's start Digital Classroom. And there we are. As you can see, Anouye and I are together. And normally, that actually means that Anouye also wants to say something. So, Anouye, what do you want to say today?
Well, last week, the new USB-C cables arrived from Tether Tools. And one is really special because this is the extension cable, including a small booster. And I've got a client who tried it out. Thank you, Wop. And it works as a charm. So, you can pre-order it now. First batch is already sold out. In January, we expect a lot more in orange or black, 4.6 meters, so that's a lot.
We only like the orange.
If you need to extend your USB-C cable, for example, if you're shooting a USB-C camera to an iMac, which only has USB-C, this is the solution for you, 4.6 meters.
And you know what I also like? Is that it's angled.
No, this is another cable. This is the
USB-C. Yeah, but
USB-C.
This is the normal USB-C cable, but it's angled.
It's angled.
And I really think that helps a lot because when you put this in your camera, it doesn't stick out. It's literally, you push it in, it's flush, and I like angled cables.
Also in black and orange.
And nice thick.
This one is called the Tether Boost Pro 3.
So there's a booster inside the cable.
Yeah, and it's really small. It's really compact.
Now imagine the first boosters we ever used, and a booster is, by the way, if you don't know why you need a booster, sometimes it happens that your camera loses connection or your files are a little bit like it comes in and then immediately it comes in a lot and then it goes slower. That's mostly, let me put it this way, it's like a blockade in your digital stream. And what a booster does is gives your camera a little bit of extra juice. And that makes the transition a lot easier because over your distance, you will actually lose, of course, a little bit of that power. But by using a booster, you can literally boost that power a lot. And the first boosters we used, believe it or not, they were about this big.
Yeah.
So they were
this big.
And they were black. You needed batteries. And the reason they were this big and also this thick was actually because this was the booster and this was the battery pack you had to put on it. They were square, so it doesn't look like a cable. But it was a lot of shit. Let me put it that way. It didn't work at all. And then we got the new Tether Boost, and that was like twice as big as this one. And that's the one I'm still using today. When I look at this, this is insane. Look at how small that is. Oh, it gets bigger. Look at how small that is. So, yeah, camera doesn't see depth, right? It only sees stuff that's closer to it, bigger. Okay, so new cables from Tether Tools. Awesome, Anouye.
If you want more information, check out our Instagram or tethertools.com.
Without any doubt. And Anouye has a really cool Instagram for Tether Tools, tethertools.nl. You're going to love it.
Now, no, it's without the dot. It's tethertools.nl.
Oh, yeah, tethertools.nl on Instagram.
Instagram.
We'll leave the link below.
Yeah.
Now, for today, we are having something really special planned. We have something really special planned. Now, but you all need to help me out with this one. So if you like us, you have to help us out with this. Grab your phone, grab your tablet, grab your computer, it doesn't matter, and go to this website. You don't have to do anything yet. Just go to the Kahoot.it. Just remember that one.
You will need it later.
You will need it later?
When we start the quiz.
Okay. Because, hey, you already told them. We are having a quiz today with you guys. It's 10 questions. And you can actually win Absolutely nothing.
Nothing.
It's just for fun.
Just
but
fun.
It's a great thing
it's
that
fun.
We want to incorporate this more into our live streams and into our digital classrooms, but also during workshops and trade shows. So we are testing this out, and if it works fine, we will keep using it. Okay, Annemiek, do you have something to do in between, or are you going to check the chats on YouTube?
Yes, I will check the chats in the other room, Frank.
Okay, cool, because you bring Chewy with you then, right?
Yeah.
And then you want to be the quiz master today, right?
Yes.
So as soon as we do the quiz,
I will help
you will be back.
I will help you out.
Okay, so Annemiek is Stay going away with Chewy, because we don't have any interns at the moment here. Bobs is at home. Hey, Bobs. And that's because yesterday actually started a new lockdown for the Netherlands up until January 19th. All essential shops are open, like supermarkets, but everything else is closed. So that means that we don't want to have our intern over here. Of course, we didn't do that anyway. And I'm just doing digital classroom nicely from my home location, which is awesome. Okay, today, mobile workflows, mobile stuff. What is it all about? Is it only for freaks like us that really like mobile stuff, or is it for everybody? One of the things that I found out recently, and I didn't like finding that out, but we did, is actually that during this whole lockdown, we can't do anything with models. I don't think it's, we can of course do something with models, but I don't think it gives the right signal. And of course it also, it just doesn't feel right at the moment. So we didn't do anything with our models. So that means that actually over this period of months, I still wanted to shoot, and I love shooting in nature. But to bring my big camera with me all the time, that's a little bit of a drag. And of course, on a mountain bike, you want to carry as little as possible. Now, one thing that we always have with us, of course, is our mobile phones, right? And I even have two at the moment here. Wow, what a looks. So we can do stereo shoots. Nah, I'm just kidding. Okay, so we always have our mobile phone with us, but how is the image quality of your mobile phone? Now, overall, I have to be honest, it's not a professional camera by any stretch, but it comes really, really close to replacing a point-and-shoot camera. And I think that part has to be really, really secure in your minds before we continue this. It will never compare to a professional camera. I don't care how much software you throw at it, a professional camera will be better. That being said, oh man. It's getting really, really close. So this is a Huawei P30 Pro. This is my own phone. I love this phone. It has a 40 megapixel sensor, but it does pixel binning. So you get 10 megapixel, but you can also shoot on 40. Now, if the weather is right, if the light is right, awesome image quality. That's great. 40 megapixels. Pure bliss. Absolutely amazing. However, as soon as you get a little bit of backlight, the autofocus fails. If you have a little bit of motion, the autofocus fails. If you have a little bit less perfect light, you will see that on that 10 megapixel file, everything looks fine. But on that 40 megapixel file, it really falls apart really, really fast. There's a lot of dynamic range, but it falls apart like crazy. So I was thinking, isn't there a brand that thinks a little bit differently, because there's something else that frustrates the living daylights out of me, and that is operating the camera. As a professional photographer, you are used to certain things like setting up your shutter speed, choosing which way your autofocus works, you're choosing your white balance. I don't want to shoot on JPEGs and RAWs. Why? I just want to shoot on RAWs, and I want to make sure that I don't have a smart RAW or pro RAW, yeah, but I want the real RAW file, so when I go into Lightroom or into Photoshop, I can literally work on my maximum file quality, right? So, yes. Yeah, and then you go to your mobile phone, and the first thing you will notice as soon as you grab your mobile phone is that you will actually see that everything works a little bit different from your camera. Logical, right? Because it's a different device. And that's when I started to think, and I started to look online like, hey, I want to replace my phone. It's not really necessary, but you know how guys are, right? Sometimes we want something new to play with. And it is very, very striking to see that actually all the phones have a similar sort of camera, and it works like a charm, but it's nothing compared to my own camera. And this is where I got the idea, let's try out the Sony Xperia. And now, I have to be very, very clear about something. I am a Sony ambassador, so that means that I'm shooting with Sonys already from, I think, starting the A99. We were actually the first ones ever that got the A99 tethering, because at that point there was no A99 on the market. We had a beta sample, it didn't tether into Lightroom or Capture One, and we actually got it working into, I believe at that point, it was, I believe, Capture One, where we actually got it working in Lightroom, thanks to a company that literally created that driver. So I've been with Sony for a very long time, but I never really used their smartphones. And I don't know why, but I think there is a little bit of a thing that you have to realize. When Samsung or Apple releases a phone, you have this really nice show where they go, oh, this is the most amazing thing, it's magic. And people go like, I need that. I don't even care what it costs, I need that. And then the next day you can order it. So you buy that new phone, you are happy with it, and you have instant gratification. I think the thing that Sony does wrong is that they announce the phone, people get all excited, but not like Apple or Samsung, it's smaller, people get excited, and then it takes a lot of months before those phones actually reach people. And then when you look at the specs, 12 megapixels, 12 megapixels, 12 megapixels. So three cameras, 12 megapixels. It isn't as exciting as 104 megapixels and 64 in your main and 48 for your wide. You go like, I need that one. Yes, I made the same mistake. Without any doubt, I also thought I needed 100 meg. Nah, not 100, but 40 seems nice, right? The thing is, realize this. The sensors inside the Samsung and probably also inside the Huawei are Sony sensors. Why do you think that Sony lets Samsung use 100 megapixels and they use 12 themselves? This is a choice. And I think as a professional photographer, I agree with them for 99.9%. I love megapixels, let's be honest. And I think 20, 24 is about the sweet spot. So 12, it is a little bit on the low side. I would love to see 20 or 24, but bear with me. The other thing is pixel width and depth, of course. Now, what you need to realize is if you have a bucket of water and it's a big bucket, you can throw in a lot of water. If you have a small bucket, you can only throw in a little bit of water. Now, calculate this back into sensors for a camera. It means that a bigger sensor can capture more light. Now, a lot of people confuse this with, oh, so you're shooting f/1.8 instead of 2.8. No, that's the aperture. It is the bucket in which you collect light. And the more light you get in, the faster, of course, your autofocus will be. No, that's also the aperture. What do you have with that bigger bucket? You literally have more dynamic range, less noise, because it captures more light at the same period of time. So this is really interesting. But there's something else that I really love. And I have to do a little bit of a tweak here, so I hope this works. I'm going to switch over to another camera. And I'm going to show you the phone app. Okay, so what you see now is actually my phone. So let's switch over to the... Let me first do it like this. And let's switch over to the one that we angled. There we go. Awesome, right? And let's go to my Photo Pro app. Okay, so this is what I absolutely love. Everything you see here, you can change. So now I'm on shutter priority mode, so I can change my shutter speed really fast and easy. I can change my autofocus for single shot, continuous, or manual focus. That's awesome. I can also, of course, do my focus areas wide or center. This is very, very close to what I have on my own Sonys. I can do my exposure compensation. Really nice. You see it in real life. We have ISO. And that's now, of course, disabled because I'm on S mode. We have metering mode, center, and spot. So this is absolutely awesome because this looks exactly like my professional camera. And I can shoot RAW or RAW and JPEG. And now comes the kicker. We can also go to program mode. Nah, not my thing. Shutter priority or full manual. Yes, full manual. That's awesome. Now, of course, the only thing you can't change is your aperture, for the very simple reason, that's fixed. Okay, now I can change my ISO, and as you can see here, we go all the way up to 3200. You don't want to use that, trust me. And this. Now, the cool thing about this is it absolutely looks like a normal camera. It operates like a normal camera, and you have a shutter button. And let me switch back to the other camera for that. So I'm going to show you that very quickly. So let's go back to that one, and let's switch back to my face. Okay, there we go. Now, the thing is, and this is pure what I love about it. This is the shutter button. And it means that as soon as I want to take a picture, I just press the button, and my phone starts up immediately in the Pro camera app. You can set it up for normal camera or Pro camera. And for me, of course, I like to use the Pro camera. So at that point, you can literally just press that shutter button. The other thing that I really like about this, let me switch over to my iPad very quickly. Sorry, guys. Okay. Somebody is at the door, so Chewy is going totally berserk. Sorry for that in the background. Okay, so the other thing that is really nice is that it actually functions like a shutter button. So you know on your camera when you want to nail the focus, you half press and then you press through? That's exactly the same on the phone. So when I want to focus on something, I literally just press, I half press, and then I press through and it takes the picture. Okay, but if everything works nicely, but the autofocus is slow, the phone doesn't work, right? I can guarantee you that whatever you want to shoot with this, it's fast enough to literally just nail, even Chewy, when he walks around and he's jumping around, it will literally nail that focus. Now, when I shoot Chewy, I really have to do it on continuous autofocus for the very simple reason, otherwise it won't work. Okay, so we're going to set everything up for the iPad, and then we're going to go into the other part. So we're going to start a little commercial very quickly, and I will be right back. My name is Frank Doorhoff, and I'm a fashion celebrity photographer based in the Netherlands. But most of all, I love teaching you guys about photography. Now, what is the main ingredient of photography? The model, of course, your camera, but most of all, lighting. Photography is painting with light, telling your story with light. And so light is the most important thing in photography. But still, 99% of the photographers let the lighting control them. While in essence, you as a photographer should be able to control the lighting. And that's why this video is created. It's a video about the essential lighting techniques, the lighting techniques that you should learn. How to create a white backdrop, or how to create a black backdrop, how to make sure that there's still shadow in your lighting. But most of all, how about the essential lighting, like Rembrandt, butterfly, feathering your light, making sure that your model is lit the correct way. In this video, we're gonna do all those techniques. And way more. Very simple tips about how to control your shadows. We talk about light meters. We talk about my favorite plugins. If you're a starting photographer, this is the video for you. This is where you learn everything you need to know about lighting. And after that, you can start telling your story with great lighting. If you're a professional, I'm sure there are a lot of tips in here that also help you. So enjoy our new instructional video, available now. Okay, and we're back. So I set everything up for the iPad, and we are going to do a full workflow. So I'm going to do it as fast as possible because I don't want to keep you guys waiting with boring stuff, but we are going to do a full workflow. So bear with me. It's going to be really interesting because we're going to do some stuff that I literally didn't see online yet for skin retouching. And I do have to make very, very clear, this is a mobile workflow. This is not a workflow that mimics what you do on your computer. It's a totally new way of thinking. And I'm going to be totally bluntly honest with you guys about what misses and what is absolutely awesome. Now, Anouk is checking the YouTube chat, so if you have any questions, just feel free to ask him in the YouTube, although I did lose Anouk at the moment. I don't know where she is, but she will be back probably in a few seconds. So don't worry, if you have any questions, she will catch up with that. Okay, first things first. We did have a little bit of fun with Lois last week, and we went out with the Sony phone and actually took a little bit of a, well, a photo shoot with her. I want to show you that video first, and then we're going to go into the retouching process. I'm going to show you how we import stuff and how you can make your life a lot easier by just taking note of some very, very simple stuff that I actually had to figure out, and that's actually a disaster if you do it wrong. So let's start the video, and after that we go into the mobile workflow. Hey guys, my name is Frank Dorov and I'm the author of the book Mastering the Model Shoot. Now, you guys really like the book because we're getting a lot of rave reviews on Amazon and every other online store. So that actually triggered us to make a video series about the book. Now, in the first video, I will tell you everything about the light meter. Now, in digital photography, I think the light meter is the one thing that confuses people a lot. Shouldn't I use the histogram, Frank? Isn't there a meter inside the camera? Where do I point the meter? Towards the pretty girl? Towards the camera? Towards the light source? Where? There's a lot of confusion out there. Now, in this video, I will give you in more than 70 minutes all the insights out about the light meter. Calibrating, using incident and reflective, using a white background, how to keep details in the black, how to trigger the meter, where to point the meter. You will see everything very easily explained, but you will also see photo shoots including our model Manon. This is one of the videos if you're slightly interested in the light meter, or if you already have a light meter and you want to know everything about it, get this video. It's called Mastering the Model Shoot, the Light Meter, and it's the first video in a whole series that we're going to release in connection to our book Mastering the Model Shoot, and it's available now from our website. Okay, awesome. So we are working out some issues with, of course, our split screens. And what we did now, and the previous time what we did, is we actually ran Wirecast straight on the same laptop that we are also streaming with. And in the end, that wasn't really a well thought of thing. So what we are using now is an RGB Link Mini. They're about €299, and you can put in all these devices for HDMIs, and you can literally use picture-in-picture, as you can see here, and transitions. The only thing is the picture-in-picture, as you can see now, it blocks off part of my iPad. So we tested it out. It looks nice, but at certain points, maybe I will just switch over to the full iPad. But I also like the fact that you see me talking, especially for a slightly longer live stream. Okay, so the first thing is, of course, that whole workflow is nice. But how do you get those freaking images on that iPad? And I hear that from so many people. Now, when Apple released the iPad Pro, I was one of the first that bought the 12.9-inch. Awesome, they promised a lot, and they never, ever delivered. It was just a blown-up iPhone. So I was just going like, okay, let's sell it. And then a few years later, they actually changed their game a lot. And nowadays, the iPad Pro is literally a beast. It can retouch videos faster than my i9 Dell, which is insane because that's an i9 with 32 gigs. And I'm literally faster on the iPad Pro with LumaFusion or Project Rush from Adobe, which is growing into a really nice solution, by the way. If you also use Premiere, it's awesome. But I'm not a real video editor, so I don't do any live streams on video editing. So, for photography. Now, the first thing, of course, is how do you get those images on your iPad Pro? Well, that's very, very easy. And let me see if I have one here. And I don't. I think it's still in the living room, but that doesn't matter. You need a small dongle for it. Now, I have a dongle on my iPad at the moment. Let me pick it up so you guys can see. So, it's a small dongle. I also have one on my laptop because nowadays a lot of those machines only have USB-C and you need more inputs, right? So the dongle I'm using is actually a dongle that's really cheap. I believe it was €25. I also have one that's €99 and I can't see the difference, to be honest. And it has HDMI, network, two USBs and a USB-C and of course HDMI, which is for me very important because that's how you now see the screen. And it has card readers, so it has a micro SD slot and a normal SD slot. The nice thing about Lightroom is that you can literally just import files, so you don't need to do anything difficult, you just put it on. So let's say I want to import some files here, you just press plus, and you say from files or from camera roll or whatever you want to do. If you're from files, you will literally just end up in your browser, and you can, for example, go to on my iPad. And you can import images from there. For example, if you want to import something from Chewy, now this is video, of course, or if you want to import something from, well, there's no pictures on here because I all have them in Lightroom, but you get the drift, right? You can do it from a card reader, you can do it from files, whatnot more. You can do it from everywhere you want. But there's something else, and that's even much better. Now, I use Lightroom on my iPad for the very simple reason, the Apple Pencil. This is awesome. So I use it on my iPad Pro, but all my pictures I take with my Sony Xperia 1 Mark II, right? So how do I get those images straight into Lightroom? Well, if you watch closely, you can actually see that, for example, this shot, I literally took, I think 2 hours ago, and it's already in my iPad, but it didn't import anything. It's just there. So how did that happen? Well, this is the trick. In Lightroom, in your settings, you can actually say in import, add photos. Oh, sorry. On my phone, it works like that. There we go. And go to import. And now what you do is auto add from camera roll, photos, screenshots, or videos. If you do photos, you can literally, I don't know why this one doesn't do it, but on my Android, I can literally choose which directory. For example, screenshots, I don't want in my Lightroom, that I just make them. My JPEG files, I don't need in Lightroom. Everything from WhatsApp, I don't need in Lightroom. So everything that gets into the camera roll also uploads to Lightroom. You don't want that. So on my Android device, let me check very quickly if I'm not lying to you guys and if I'm missing something. But on the Android device, you can literally say which folders to upload. So let me try that out very quickly, because I want to give you guys, of course, the proper information, device info and storage. Okay. And now go to import. Yep, here I can literally say enable auto add, import selected formats, import from all locations or only folders. And I can literally just do it in folders. Now, this is one of the things that does frustrate me a little bit, because I have a lot more options in my Android as in my, and I just recently found it out. So let's say import. Yeah, there's a lot missing there. Just to give you an idea, this is what's on the phone. So on Android, you have a lot more options. Now, this is not weird or the first time this has happened, because at first, there's also no option, for example, to copy your presets over. So you could copy one, but you couldn't select all the images and then copy all the settings. On Android, that's, I believe that was already there from the start. On iOS, it catched up a little bit later. So I think in the end, it will be okay. So everything that I shoot on my phone, only the raw files will be uploaded into Lightroom. And then, of course, as soon as I open up my iPad, all the images are there. So this is also what we did with the shoot from Lois, of course. Took the images and just started up Lightroom on the phone, put the phone away, and then when I got home, all the images were already on your iPad. Do make sure that you don't use also cellular network. Only do this via Wi-Fi, otherwise you will lose a lot of money by uploading all the images constantly, because at one point you forget, you're walking around, you take 1 gig of photos, or 200 megabytes or whatever, and your whole data is gone. Now we have unlimited over here, so we don't really care. Okay, so all the images are there. So what can you do now? Let me first start out by the things that I hate about the mobile workflow. We started with the whole mobile workflow, I think about a year ago, just before our trip to South Africa. After that, I took it with us to America for Photoshop World. And between those two dates, I changed only one thing that made a huge difference. And that was actually install the beta of ISO 13. Now we are, of course, at ISO 14. What was the difference? The difference was using external drives. And that's the thing. Before that, you couldn't use anything from an external drive. The Files app wasn't there. So that meant that getting something off your iPad, you needed to use, for example, the DJI Copilot, which is an awesome device, but copying 1 terabyte of files to your computer was fast, but copying 300 megabytes from my iPad to the DJI Copilot was incredibly slow. So that didn't really work out unless you want to spend 2 hours waiting. So after I uploaded the new beta version, I could use external drives. This changed a lot. There was only one huge problem, and I don't know if you guys experienced this. If you do, this is the solution. Whenever you're in Files, so let me open up Files for you guys so you know what I'm talking about. As soon as you are in Files, you might think like, okay, now I can copy everything to an external hard drive, right? So just swipe up half, hold Files, and drag it next to it. And then, for example, go here. Let me just make something really easy. Go to my iPad. Let's create a folder here. I already have probably one. Nope. So create a new folder. And just call it temp for now. Okay, there you go, temp. And now you might say, okay, just pick this up and just drag it over. Works like a charm, right? I can do it any way you want. So that's cool. So let's delete that folder. No problem at all. We can delete it. Wow, Files really works. Yeah. You see what happened? That was already a little bit of a bug. I wasn't in that folder when I deleted it. So why did it change that? That's weird. Now, when you want to copy something to an external hard drive, you go like, okay, just external hard drive it. So go to Files, go back, and then there's somewhere there you can find your external hard drive. And this is where everything went wrong for me, and I was totally pissed off, to be honest. At first, I didn't notice it. Luckily, we still had backups, because all the video files we copied and a lot of the raw files, I couldn't open anymore on the other computer from the backup. What happened? It was totally butchered. So my videos didn't run, my photos had artifacts or didn't open at all. And I was just going like, what's going on? 10 photos work, 1 photo doesn't. 10 videos work, 2 doesn't. I don't know what's going on. Then another problem came. When we do videos for YouTube, what we actually do is we go to, for example, backup folder for SSD, go to final videos, go, for example, the XP Pen 24, and then just share that with YouTube. Right? Or you open up YouTube in your browser and you go Files, you go there and you upload it. The thing was that everything I uploaded something to YouTube, after about 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 5 minutes, it just stopped uploading. I was going like, what the heck's going on? What is this? So I gave the file to Anyweek. Yeah, the file is corrupted. I was kind of like, eh, that's weird. It plays fine. That's when we found out that there was a serious issue. Now, if you run into this issue, the solution is incredibly simple. Copy everything to your Photos app. So when you want to copy something to YouTube, what you have to do is have files open, swipe up just a little bit, and make sure that this is why I have my photos in the bottom bar. Pick up Photos, swipe it there, and now just swipe whatever you want. Let's say I want to do the XP pen, swipe that to recent, there you go. And now you can upload it straight to YouTube, and it goes like a charm. It doesn't crash at all, and it doesn't butcher your files. Weird, right? So how do you make a backup in your mobile workflow? Because let's be honest, I can take great pictures, I can retouch those images, I have Lightroom. How do I get them off Lightroom? And a lot of people will go like, okay, go to the cloud. Yeah, I don't want to upload 1 terabyte to the cloud or 1 gig. I don't want to do that. I want to keep it fast. And that's actually where another solution comes in. So let's browse here. And this is a free app or a paid app. I have the paid app, but you can also use a free app, and it's called File Browser. Okay. Now, what File Browser does, and I don't get it why it works. I talked to the guys and they explained it to me. What they do is they build a sort of, I hope I explained it correctly, they build a sort of sandbox within iOS, and they double check all the files. Now, you might say, hey, Frank, isn't that then way slower? And this is the kicker. When I copy something from files to an external hard drive, so remember, this is the version that butchers everything. For example, 10 videos take 10 minutes. I'm just giving you an example, right? When I first copy it to File Browser, that's instant because it's internal memory, right? And then when I copy it from File Browser to an external drive, which checks everything, it's only 1 minute. And I go like, what's going on? I don't want to know. They don't know. Just remember, if you have that problem that it butchers your images, and trust me, you do. If you didn't find it out yet, go back to everything you copied in the past and you will find out that there is a lot of stuff that you lost. The only thing you do is download the free file browser. This is the File Browser Biz, so this one costs you money. And the only thing you have to do is connect your external USB drive, and just go here, USB drive, and then USB drive, of course, is unavailable now. Attach different storage, and you can literally just open your Files app. There you go again. Click on that USB drive and just say, this is the USB drive. And now you will have an extra option in USB drive up there, and you can drag all your files over there. And that works like a charm. It doesn't butcher anything. It just works. Don't ask me why, but it works like a charm. This is one of the things that I really don't like about Apple, is that these kinds of bugs, they're now here for a year, and it's, I think, one of the most important things, getting your files off an iPad, and it just still doesn't work. So I don't think anybody from Apple is listening, but if they are, fix that, man, really. Okay, another thing that I don't like about the mobile workflow, tethering via cable. There's a software package called out Cascable. It works for an A7R 3 from Sony, not the A7R 4. Now, seeing that the A7R 4 is already on the market for a long time, I think that's not a solution that you can trust, for the very simple reason, probably it's somebody that creates that software out of a hobby, which most of the app developers is, of course. It looks amazing, and when you see it on an A7R 3, it's great. But I don't want to wait a year for a new camera to be supported. So tethering via cable is something that I really want on the iPad Pro. So if there's an app developer working on it, contact me. I'm willing to test whatever you want. I have to have that working. Wireless works via the Sony app, or soon via the AirDirect from TetherTools. And if you have Canon or Nikon, it already works with the AirDirect. Only Sony doesn't work yet. Another thing that is a little bit of a problem, and that can be a big one, is renaming files in Lightroom. That's not possible. The reason for this is probably because you are using a cloud server. So that means that all the files are in the cloud and you have your files on your iPad. The thing that I don't get is that I have my iPad set up for only download smart previews. Those aren't big. So if I want to change a name, why not just change the name in the cloud and then download the smart previews again? This is something that I really would wish Adobe would address, because renaming your images is really, really vital. Okay, now the good stuff. everything is on your iPad Pro. That means that wherever you go, you have a device with you that's super, super fast, that has a really cool retouching capability with the Apple Pencil, and it has battery life to die for. It's literally, when you start in the morning, in the end, it's still going. Probably at the end, it will be at 10 or 20%, but it still goes. To give you an idea, when we traveled back from South Africa to the Netherlands, I did 3 vlog episodes in LumaFusion. I did some movie watching and, of course, read some comics and I did some games. And as soon as we landed in Amsterdam, that's about a 10-hour flight, I believe, my iPad was still for 30% full, which blew my mind, because if I do that on my laptop, I can probably edit and render one vlog and that's about it. Then the battery dies and you can't keep it on your lap anymore because it's blazingly hot. And the iPad, it didn't care at all. This is also why I'm very interested in the M1 laptops from Apple, who are they have out. But read my blog. We have an M1 here and it's going back to Apple. So read my blog if you want to know why. Okay, so we have everything in the iPad Pro. What is more that I really like? Actually, the whole process, the whole stuff about getting those images on, retouching the images, but then getting them into your Lightroom in your computer. Now, I don't know how you guys work, but I am still a Lightroom Classic user. I like Lightroom, but the Classic version just has way more, like renaming files, tethering, and whatnot more. And this is the thing that I really like about the solution that Adobe actually figured out. In Lightroom Classic, you can literally download everything you have in the cloud. You even have the same albums, and the only thing you have to do is drag it into your Lightroom catalog. It's really easy to set up. If you want to see it in a video, I can do it, but it's literally in your preferences of Lightroom. You can set up Lightroom Mobile and it will literally just copy everything over. So that means that as soon as I'm home, I don't have to bring my phone, I don't have to bring my iPad. All the images I shot are already there. Do make sure you have enough room in the cloud, of course, because RAW files can get pretty big. So, what can the iPad handle? 66 megapixels? No problem at all. That's about the highest we can send over to it, and it works like a charm. But then the retouching. When I retouch on my computer, I of course have Photoshop. I have all my plugins, like for example, exposure software for tinting, DxO Film Lab. We have, of course, Luminar, and of course, our skin retouching software from Topaz, or of course, Portraiture from Imagenomic. What do we have on the iPad? We only have Lightroom. Now, there are some things that I've changed in Lightroom that literally will make a huge difference in how you edit your images. So let's just take a little bit of a look. I hope I don't lose any connections when I pick everything up. Nope, it goes okay. Okay, so I'm gonna sit down. And let me just look at one of the images. Let me take this one from Lois. Okay, now Lois has a pretty good skin. Let me make sure that everything is nice in the image. So she has a pretty good skin, but as you can see, there are still some smaller areas that we need to address. So of course you can use your healing brush and set it on heal. Make it a little bit smaller. There you go. And then just press. And you can move that around those circles. And of course, make sure that you do it the right way around. There we go. It's all pretty straightforward, right? So let's just press done. Okay, so, okay, nice. But one of the things that, of course, you want to do is you want to make that skin a little bit more glowy, a little bit more interesting. Now, I never saw anybody doing it this way, and I think it's absolutely brilliant. It works like a charm, and let me hope that you guys can work with this. Okay, so let's start. I want to smoothen the skin a little bit. Now, one of the things that you will do a lot when you work on, for example, Photoshop is, for example, dodge and burn. Now, of course, we can't do dodge and burn here because it will take a lot of time, and I don't really like that technique. I always was more for the filters. So let's see if we can do something similar. Now, in Lightroom, and of course also on the computer, you have something called the adjustment brush. You can find it there. It's that little thingy. Now, as soon as you see this, you go like, okay, and now? Okay, press the plus, and now you can see a brush. Awesome, now I can change the brush size. So let's make the brush size a little bit smaller. Oops, sorry. Okay. I don't want it too big. There we go. Okay, and just painting. Now I'm going to do it really sloppy, so you guys of course have to do it much, much nicer, because you guys have way more time than I do during a live stream. Okay, let's only do the face. And of course, if you're not happy with the selection, you can just use your eraser and just make your mask a little bit nicer. There you go. But I think for now this will be okay, just do the nose a little bit more. There we go. Okay, looks like she has a mask on. Okay, now go for light, and the first thing I always do is actually raise the highlights. I don't do it too much, but I just give a little bit more. And the shadows, because one of the things that you see a lot in skin is actually pores, and that's a play between highlights and shadows. So you can literally just even that out a little bit. So even after doing this, it already looks better. Okay, but we have more. Go to effects and then turn down the texture until you like what you see. Up the clarity to get more contrast, or lower the clarity. If you have somebody with really bad skin, just lower the clarity. With texture, you can literally determine how many pores you see. And then with dehaze, you can fine tune the shadow areas. And there you go, press done. And now see the before and after, before and after. Before and after. Now if you go, it's a little bit too much. Just click there, go for light. I think the highlights are a little bit too. There you go. And of course you can combine whatever effects you want. Detail, you can add some noise. Now in all honesty, the noise can help a little bit sometimes to get a little bit of that pore effect back. But I'm not a real fan of that, to be honest. I like grain in here, but you can't do grain. So that's another thing that I don't really like at the moment about the mobile workflow. You miss a lot of stuff that makes life really, really easy. But overall, when you compare it to the original, I think it does pretty well for skin. So let's try something a little bit more daring. Let's go to this image from Claudia. And let's just skip that whole part about doing that healing. Let's say I'm really in a rush. I want to do a rush job. So let's go here, let's go plus, let's go for the brush, let's go for paint. Okay, so I'm now in rush, so I'm doing it really fast. As you can see, I'm just going over a lot of stuff that I don't need to go over. I'm going to take my eraser, and the eraser I make really small. There we go. And with the eraser I now fine tune my mask. It's just what you like to do. Sometimes I like to do it really rough and then fine-tune it with the eraser. Sometimes I do it the other way around. It just depends on your own personal preference. And I do them both, so I still don't know which one I like most. Okay, do the same thing. Go for light, highlights a little bit, those shadows that really makes a huge difference, and go for effects. And now go back for your texture. Use clarity to even it out. There we go. And then a slight dehaze. And there you go. And press done. Before, after. And now I can still use, of course, my clone tool or healing brush to take out the smaller details. Awesome, right? Very, very simple to do. Now let's say that you want to go into Photoshop to do some other stuff. Hey, Photoshop. Oh, hey, there is a Photoshop on the iPad. Now go here, go for export, and go for edit in Photoshop. Now, the first thing you will notice is this is not a game. One of the things that I hated about the mobile workflow before Photoshop on the iPad and Lightroom on the iPad was that if you want to open something up in, for example, a Snapseed, then it's a JPEG. You open up a JPEG, it's in Snapseed, and then you export it as a JPEG, as RGB, and it just looks like crap. To be totally honest, I put in a 60 megapixel file that was absolutely awesome. I got it back from Snapseed, and I was just looking at it going like, okay, I can use it on social media, but after that, just delete it, because it was compressed the heck out of it, and it wasn't 60 megapixels anymore. As soon as Photoshop started up on the iPad, one thing that I loved about them is they understand what we want. We want PSD files, we want TIFFs, we want Adobe RGB, Pro Photo RGB. I don't care which color space the iPad supports, I want to be able to save in those workspaces for the very simple color spaces. For the very simple reason, when I'm home, I have a great computer, and on that computer, I can use those final retouching steps. So why not? Okay, so what it now does, it actually saves this in the cloud as a PSD, so it's a huge file. This is a 60 megapixel file. And now I'm in Photoshop, and now I can do some other stuff. Now, in all honesty, in Photoshop, there is a lot of stuff missing. And one of the most important things that I find missing is actually, and believe it or not, add noise. Now, why do I use add noise? For example, let me switch over very quickly to Lightroom. When I look at an image like this, and I look at the backdrop, I can get that backdrop perfectly in Photoshop on the computer. What I do is I cut the model out, I blur the backdrop, and then you get those weird Newton rings, or in other words, you don't have enough bit depth to render those small gradients. And then what you do is you just add a little bit of noise, 0.5 or 1, and you have a perfect backdrop. Well, that doesn't work because Photoshop doesn't have the add grain. Yes, Annemiek, do we have any questions on YouTube?
Yes, there was a question on YouTube from Fred and Ineke.
Okay, and what is the question?
It was about the phone.
Okay, we got a question about the phone, so I'm going to answer that first. But first, I forgot one very, very important thing. One of the things that I love to do when I take photos is actually save my location. And with my old phone, with the Huawei, it did save locations in the JPEGs, but not in the RAW files. And because I throw away the JPEGs, that was a lot of extra work. So import everything into Lightroom, run a software package that takes all the location information from the JPEGs into the RAWs, and then you have your location files. And if you forget it, you lost your location file where you shot it. And especially when you're traveling or you're mountain biking, you want to know where you took that shot, right? And the Sony actually stores that location inside the RAW file. And that's so much easier because now I don't have to do anything. The location is already in the RAW file. I hope they also start to introduce that, by the way, in their own cameras, which, by the way, they do. But you have to figure that out. And if you want, I can make a video about that too. Leave comments below. You have to turn on your Sony Play Memories Live. It was in the past. Now it's called Edge. And when you run Edge and you combine it with your camera and you walk around, it will actually store the information from your phone, so the GPS information, into your RAW files. That's awesome. But that doesn't work 100%, so yeah. Okay, so we are now in Photoshop, and the cool thing is you can tilt, you can zoom in, and you can zoom in like crazy. And as soon as you're used to this, you don't want to go back. Every time I'm now behind my computer, I go like, oh, I wish. But in the future, this will work, I hope. Okay, so what can I do in Photoshop? In all honesty, Photoshop at the moment isn't my thing. It's very, very basic. I actually prefer Lightroom at the moment. But if you want to work in layers, Photoshop just works like a charm because you can literally just create layers. And I'm not going to show you a lot about Photoshop. I just wanted to show you very quickly what you can do with the skin in retouching. So let me first start out by just showing you very quickly what you can do. So let's do a duplicate layer. And let's just go, for example, in an area where we want something a little bit more smooth in the skin. Okay, so of course you can blur the skin, but what if you don't want to blur the skin? If you go like, hey Frank, when I look at her face, I don't know, man, it looks nice, but it's not my thing. Okay, I get it. So you want it a little bit more natural, but you still want to take out some issues. Now, of course, you can do Dutch and burn. Again, I'm not a big fan of it. What you can do is you create two layers, one with highlights, one with shadows, and you just start painting them in. It's not my thing. So anyway, go to the clone tool, and you can find that here. It's the healing brush or the clone. Go to clone, change the size of your brush to whatever you find reasonable. Oh, sorry. Change the hardness, and I always do it on zero, by the way. I want to make the brush just a little bit bigger. There you go. Change the opacity to really low, for example, 25%. And now what you do is you have to press here. I hope you can see that. No, you can't see that. Let me switch over to full camera mode for now. One moment. Just turn picture in picture off. And now you see me. And now you're full screen. Okay. So we're going to press here, as you can see. And now I can sample, for example, here. And you see that little pointer? Okay. So it's sampled there. And what I'm now going to do is I'm just going to fade everything. So by using a very, very low opacity on your brush, you can literally just fade out the skin a little bit. And sample, for example, here. Oh, sorry. You have to press it really nice. And this way, you can make skin a little bit nicer and a little bit smoother without literally using filters. And I think this works like a charm, especially if you want your skin to look absolutely normal and you don't want that overly smoothed skin. This is a way that works like a charm. But don't ever do this on a too high opacity. On a too low opacity. As you can see here, you can already see some issues. Just double click with two fingers and it's an undo. Let me show you what happens when we change the opacity to, for example, 65. This doesn't work at all anymore. I'm sampling. You already see it. I'm sampling and I'm going to do. See? That just doesn't look nice. It's a little bit too much. Okay, so go back. So leave that opacity as low as 25. 25 works great. Sample somewhere, for example here, and just paint it over. Now, of course, Claudia has great skin, so do cancel. Let's take something else. Discard. Okay, we're also streaming, so this takes a little bit longer. Little bit. Oh, of course, I have two layers. That's not smart. Ah, there we go. Okay, let's take one off with really harsh light. Nadine, we shot with really harsh light. Okay, so let's try this first. Let's go for adjustments. Let's go for plus. Let's paint in my mask. Now let's do this a little bit nicer. Nadine, of course, is a great model, so we have a lot of images from Nadine. And her skin is actually pretty good for the very simple reason she doesn't have any color differences in her skin, and that's a biggie. We can always work away with small like pores or wrinkles. That's no problem at all in retouching. That's easy. But as soon as a model has uneven skin color, that's a disaster. I can have a lot of trouble with that. Well, something like this really works fine. Okay, let's only focus on the face and the neck up until here, so you guys see that. You catch the drift, right? It works for everything. Okay, go back to... Oh, come on. There we go. Go back to light. Okay, first things first. First, balance the highlights. There we go. A little bit of shadow. Then go for effects. Down on the texture. Change the clarity, in case of Nadine, also a little bit down. And then dehaze her. There we go. Looks pretty fine. There you go. Look at the difference. Wow. Okay. Go edit into Photoshop. Anouk, do we have more questions on YouTube?
You forgot to answer the other question.
Oh, I didn't answer the question at all. You're right.
About the phone.
Okay. What is the question?
It was about settings.
Settings on the phone, okay.
On the phone or in Lightroom for importing files.
Okay, for importing files, you set it on your phone. So the phone you are shooting with, this is where you put Lightroom in to import files from location. So that means that literally you import it from your phone into Lightroom. And then, of course, on your iPad, you don't have to because you don't import anything. Okay, so here we are. Okay, now let's take out some of the issues that are still there. Let's first make sure that there's no dust on my on my device. Okay. Okay. Let's duplicate my layer just to make sure. And you can always show layer by just tapping here. And you can also do this, but that's a little bit too much for me. You can use your blending modes, but hey, you probably already worked with Photoshop, right? Okay. So first, let's take out this. Let's do it with the healing brush for now. And the thing is, we still have the healing brush And it's a spot healing brush. So you can do sample all layers or use pressure for size. Now, in this case, we're going to use pressure for size, but it's really nice. And I'm sampling all layers. Now, don't do it because I want to show you the difference between before and after. Okay, so let's just undo this. And this is what Photoshop does. And it's not bad. It's not bad at all. It works like a charm. Let's do here. Okay. Not bad. Now let's see what we can do. Go into your clone tool. Now remember the setting. Opacity around 25. Size not too large, not too small. There we go. And now we have to sample. So we use that little box over there. And you can drag that around where you want. Sample here. And now just gonna close those eyes just a little bit more. Sample again. Sample here, sample there, sample here, and just massage all those little unevennesses you have away. Now, if you are trying this at home and you are disappointed because it doesn't work at once, trust me. I've been working with a mobile workflow now for over a year, and you don't want to know how many times I wanted to throw away my iPad. And Anouk actually catched it and said, Frank, continue. One day you will get it. Now, this is a little bit of an overreaction, of course, but it did feel sometimes like that. Because, trust me, changing your workflow over from something that you're used to something like this, it is a huge undertaking. Now, normally on the cheeks, there is always a little bit of extra detail. And in this case, it doesn't really matter. It looks nice. Only here, it's a little bit rough. So just select here and... Trust me, normally models hate it when I retouch them live because this is a really sharp lens, so you see every detail. I'm using harsh light. So yeah, this isn't very nice for the model, but hey, it looks really cool after retouch, right? Okay, now, this looks nice. And I think we are pretty much done. Let me see if we have something else that we can do. I don't want any brush changes. Okay, I think we're pretty much done. The only thing I want to show you guys now is before and after. So let's go here. And let's just disconnect that layer at all. So change the opacity to zero and look at the difference. And I hope this translates well on YouTube and Twitch. Twitch seems to be a little bit higher resolution. You see that I messed up a little bit there. And you can always use a layer mask and take that out, of course. Talking about layer masks, let's do something else. Let's do a duplicate layer. And let's add... What should we do? Let's clip that. Add clipped adjustments, and let's do curves. Okay. And what I want to do is I want to brighten the eyes. So I'm literally going to brighten the eyes. I'm just going to look only at the eyes. There we go. And now, of course, we want to make sure that we have a layer mask. Sorry, guys, I did something very, very wrong. Anyway, we have a problem here with the audio, Anouk says. So let's just forget about this for now. And let's just, you can do a layer mask and then just paint in the eyes. So that's going to be, you can do that really easy. Anouk, is it okay again?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Okay, so we're not going to touch that. So, okay, cancel. And of course, in this case, we're going to do discard, otherwise, doesn't really matter. Okay, let's go back to Lightroom and see the before. So you saw what we did in Photoshop. So we went from this all the way that you saw in Photoshop. So you can literally now do a lot with your mobile workflow, also for skin retouching. Now, if you want to make it a little bit more interesting, let's open this image. And let's go for tinting. Let's go for your highlights, of course. Let's just change this a little bit. Let's go for shadows. And let's go for color. And now we have something really cool called color grading. And this is awesome. You can do it overall, which I like. And this is, by the way, for shadows. This is for your midtones. There you go. And this is for your highlights. Highlights I like a little bit more towards blue in this case. There you go. And of course, you can do it for global. But I like it a little bit more to first do it on shadows and highlights. Now, the cool thing is when you move this around and you leave that one here. So this one you can move, and this one and you can do a lot more. Change the luminance a little bit. And there you go. Before. Oh, sorry. Before. After. Looks pretty nice. Now you can also, of course, use presets. And I created a preset pack. You can buy it for, I believe, 15 euros. Let me show you where you can get that preset pack. One moment. So if you go to frankdorhoff.com/presets, you can buy that preset pack. And that's actually also working on Lightroom CC and, of course, Lightroom Classic. So let's go there. And let's go here. Now, the cool thing about presets is that they literally change the total look of your image, as you can see here. But they keep intact what you did with the skin. So in the past, you had to first do the preset and then do your retouching. And somehow that changed, or I did something wrong all the time. But now I can first do the skin retouching and then actually run my preset, which makes it much easier for me because that's more fitting my workflow. First retouching, and then in the end, we do the color. I absolutely love this look. And of course, because it's a RAW converter, that's what I absolutely love about this, I can still change it to my heart's content. Okay. Now, at the end of this retouch session, I still find that the skin is too smooth. What do you do? And this is the part what at the moment is still a little bit frustrating, because I don't have this in my adjustment brushes, but I do have it here. And this is what I would love to see in my adjustment brushes, grain. Now, watch what happens when I only add a little bit of grain to the skin. This looks absolutely awesome now. The skin doesn't glow anymore. It looks great. But I would love to be able to do this on a layer and only paint it in the skin. And we went from literally this to this. Well, not bad. Not bad at all. Okay, let's do something else. So recently I went to my parents, and they... Let me switch back to the camera that talks a little bit easier. Okay, so recently I went to my parents with my phone, and they have a Christmas tree, and we actually made a video about it. You can find it on our YouTube channel. And I just wanted to trigger you guys to shoot Christmas trees in a different way. Now, a lot of you guys know those beautiful ornaments, those pictures you see in stock photography, for example. They look amazing, but how do you make something like that? In the studio, of course. No. You just go to your Christmas tree, and what you do is you find the lights and something that shines. Well, in a Christmas tree, everything shines, right? So let's take a look at those images and what you can do, which goes way easier, of course, than just those model shoots. Okay, so let's go for Christmas. And let's just go, for example, let's take this one. Okay, first things first, let's give them stars. Now, in this case, we already gave stars. You press the star here, and you can literally just change the stars and go for the next one, change the stars, go for the next one, change the stars, and there you go. Now, if you want to see everything that has 5 stars, you just go to filter, everything that has 5 stars, which in this case is everything, and press that. Okay, let's take this one. Now, when I see an image like this, I go like, yeah, it's interesting, but it isn't a wow image. It doesn't really do anything for me. It's just an image. Let me see if I can get now my face back in the screen. One moment. Let's go for picture in picture. This is a little bit of a drag to work with. Let's do 3, 1, and out. And now if I'm right, yes, it worked. Okay, I will show you in a second what we use for that. Okay, first things first, let's make the crop a little bit tighter. There you go. And that looks nice. I always have my lock unlocked for the very simple reason I want to be able to do my own form of... I don't want to stick to an aspect ratio. If I need to stick to an aspect ratio, of course I will. But if I don't need to, why not? Oh, and by the way, if you guys have a few seconds, grab your phone, because in a moment we're going to start this. Grab your phone and go to this website. And just wait there. Just leave your phone for a second. We will get there. Okay. Go back. Okay, I did the crop. Now I'm going to go into one of my presets. And I'm just going to do basic boost, which I absolutely love. And there you go. Now you have a totally different image. And now it looks a little bit more like those images you see in all those adverts. And you just create it yourself in seconds. There you go. Add a little bit of highlights maybe. Add a little bit of vignette. There you go. Change the midpoint. There you go. Looks pretty cool. Now let's say, oh, I really like this. Oh man, this is awesome. I want that on all those images. Okay. Long hold. Go for copy. Settings copied. Okay. Long hold. Boom, 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 boom. Everything. There you go. And just say paste. 1, 2, 3. And there you go. Isn't that awesome? And now the only thing I have to do is done. Oh, sorry. Done. And just go through them. Like, okay, I need a little bit of a tighter crop here. That's nice. Okay, next one. Same thing. Tighter crop. Okay, cool. Next one. And this is so much faster than on a computer because you're doing it with your fingers and man, this is just awesome. I like this one in 235x1. I love movies. This one I really like. And you see that we also hold some of the, I don't know how you call it. We call it slinger in the Netherlands. It's the stuff that you have in your Christmas tree. And it, we just hold it in front of the lens and it creates this really nice glow. So this is without and this is with. So this is without, you see it a little bit here underneath, but this is with a lot more. Okay, this one needs a little tighter crop, like for example, like this, maybe like this. You see there's a lot of noise, but as soon as I press done, noise is gone. And this is with the smartphone, by the way, so there is noise. If you don't like the noise, go to detail and just go for noise reduction a little bit. But what I do is color noise reduction, I always put a little bit higher. And then you keep your sharpness, but you lose that really nasty color noise. Normal noise is not bad. It's like grain. Color noise, that's what really is nasty. So you don't want that in your images. Okay, here we go. This image I don't like that much until I do this and then go into color mixer. And for example, color grading. And let's go for global. Make it a little bit warmer. There we go. Add a little bit of a vignette. There you go. Now, the cool thing is, I shot this with my parents, right? So we visited my parents on Sunday. And of course, we kept our distance, 6 feet. And I could literally edit this on my phone and send it to my mom via WhatsApp. And she was going like, did you shoot that with your phone? I was going like, she did it in Dutch, of course. I said, yes, just with my phone. She said, but that was 2 minutes ago. I said, yeah, do you like it? She said, this is amazing. So, yeah. It is amazing. The mobile workflow is just so much fun, guys, really. As you can see, it works. Okay, let's go for the Sony files really fast. And then we're going to do the quiz. Okay, so this is Lois we shot with our phone. Now, as you can see here, you will see a little bit more noise if you zoom in. And you might say, hey, that's bad for a phone. No, it's not. This is probably 600% in. When I double click, that's 100%. And there is a little bit of noise there, but it's actually pretty okay for a phone. So what do I do with this? Very simple. I first, again, do the skin. So let's do this. I'm going to do it really fast. And Lois actually doesn't need any skin retouching at all. But let's say that you need. Okay, so first do the skin. Go for light. Enter highlights. Little bit of shadows, there you go. Go for effects, go for texture down, there you go. Go for clarity, a little bit up with lowers and dehaze. Just level it out. And what I'm looking for is those sidelines. Okay, go. Before and after. Gives a little bit more bright face, and it's really nice. Okay, now, oh, which one was it? This one. Go for presets and go for my, let's go for basic boost. No, don't like that at all. I actually like it in black and white a lot, this series, but let's for now keep it in color. And these, by the way, are all the presets you will find in the pack. It's the same presets I'm using. I'm not doing any light stuff, or this is what Frank uses not. No, you get everything that I use. Oh, I like this one. Compare it to the original. Yes, much more depth. Okay, press OK. You don't want to change it too much. Okay, and because it's a roll converter, that's the nice thing. I can still change everything around. There you go. Give it a little bit more clarity overall. Texture maybe a little bit down. Okay, add a little bit of grain. That masks also the noise, of course, in the image. So that gives you a little bit nicer look. Detail. Give a little bit of noise reduction. And just go for, what should we do more? Let's tint the image. Let's go for color grading. And let's do shadows a little bit towards red. Give it a little bit of warm look. Go for the midtones. So a little bit warmer. And the highlights a little bit on the high side, which gives it a, almost like a cross-processing look. Not really, but you know what I mean, right? Instagram the heck out of a shot. Yeah. Okay. Let's go here. You can also, of course, still do your curves. So you can add a little bit of contrast here and here. For example, you can do the same trick with color balance. With your color grading, but you can also do it with curves. Probably you've seen me do this a lot. I always skip green. There you go. Okay, really nice. And before and after, just in a few seconds. And if you are a guy with vignettes, I love vignettes. Just add a little bit of a vignette. Change the midpoint a little bit. Change the roundness. There you go. And just feather the heck out of it. Awesome. Before, after. Really, really nice. And of course, if you like this, there you go again. Press, say copy. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And then paste. Apply. Now let's see if it took over, because there's one thing I didn't take notice of. Yeah, it didn't take over the local retouching. Okay, so that's cool. Because we don't want that, of course. Yeah, there's no local retouching in this one. And if I'm correct in the one that I did, there should be local retouching. So let's do this. Yeah, there we go. So that's nice. So if you do something with local retouching, it doesn't copy it to all the other images. Now, this was a really embarrassing mistake from me one time, because at one point in a photo shoot during a workshop, let me switch over to the full camera again. One moment. Let's go for S. There we go. S off. And let's go for my camera. Yeah. Okay. So a long time ago, not so long ago, I taught a workshop. And one of the things that we did in the workshop was actually shoot a portrait against our snakeskin backdrop. And whatever happened, I don't know, there was this little line of light in my snakeskin backdrop. I was kind of like, what the heck is this? So we turned off all the lighting, looked like crazy for everything. And it was like, what's going on? What is happening? I didn't know. And we tried everything. We turned all the lights off. At one point, I said, you know what? I'm going to take a picture without any lights. I took it, and there's still that light streak. I was kind of like, where's it coming from? And then I realized, before the break, I showed somebody a local adjustment in Capture One. And Capture One with me is set up, copy everything from the last image. So it just kept copying that. And that can be really frustrating, because if you nailed a look perfectly, but you also did local adjustments, and you copy that look to all the other images, and you have to take out those local adjustments, that takes a lot of time. So it's better what Adobe does. Now, don't take the local adjustments. And in Lightroom, of course, on the desktop, you can select that. And I don't think you can do it on this one. It doesn't really matter. Okay, let's see. Anouk. Anouk. I'm calling out for Anouk. Because we are starting the quiz. And before we do the quiz, let's go for a little commercial so we can set everything up. And Anouk will be here, I hope, in a second. I'm going to find her. So we created a new instructional video. And you guys are going to love this. It's Light of the Old Masters. It's, I think, the best one I did on lighting. If you want to know everything about lighting, make sure you check out this one. There we go. The Light of the Old Masters. Isn't that a great title? But what is it? Well, in the old days, we all know those pictures, right? Harcourt, George Hurrell, film noir. It's that awesome look where you have total light control. Well, this video is all about total light control and mimicking the look of those old masters. But we're going to do way more because we are not in the old times anymore, of course. We are in modern times. So we're going to talk about using flex in a modern studio. Of course, combining continuous lighting with strobes for a film noir look. How to create those really nice harsh shadows on your model, for example, from blinds. And of course, how to get mood in your pictures. I'm going to share a lot of different tips to get a nice glow in your images without breaking the bank. We're going to talk about specialty lenses like the Lens Baby system. We're going to talk about a lot of stuff that really adds that magic of the old masters to your images. The video is available now and I'm 100% sure you're going to love it. It's very technical. But I'm very sure that even if you're a beginner, you get a lot of information out of it. But this is the video about total light control, Glamour, the Light of the Old Masters, available now. Okay, guys, so let me see if I can quickly also get Enwick and me in the frame. Of course, this is more important, but hey, let's do 3 and then S again. Okay, let's see if you can. Yeah, there we are. Okay, awesome. Okay, so if you type this in your Kahoot, you can actually join us. So we're gonna wait for a few seconds for this. Let me see if there are any questions on YouTube, Annemiek. Do we have any questions?
No, just some confusion about Kahoot. We did this on Brian's school. We had like they call it ouderavond. And the teachers played this game with the parents, and it was really great.
Yeah, it was absolutely fun. I am gonna turn our camera off, by the way, because otherwise they can't see the questions.
Don't know.
Yeah, I don't think they will. So we're gonna turn our cameras off after. Let's give it another minute, because a lot of people are joining in. I was really afraid that nobody would do the interactive stuff, but this is going okay. So I think we're gonna wait a few more seconds. Okay, there we go. Now a lot of people are joining.
I'm missing our intern, or did she use?
Yeah, I probably she already fell asleep.
She used the incognito name again.
Dref? Would it be Dref? Who's Dref? Dr. F. Okay, I'm gonna switch off our cameras.
Yeah, just in case.
Just in case.
So you can see the questions. Wait a second. I will tell how it works. You can see questions, and then you see a few answers in colors, and press the colors on your phone or on your other device.
Yeah, and the one that's fastest actually wins. So it's not only about getting the answers right, it's also about how fast you can do it.
Yeah.
And trust me, there are some things in there that is a little bit, you have to guess and you have to know me, but most of all, it's pretty serious. And if you did notice, paid attention during this broadcast, you will probably know the answer.
You got 10 seconds.
I've got 10 seconds?
10 okay, seconds for the answers.
Start.
Yeah.
Are you ready, guys?
I'm ready.
1, 2, go. Start. Workflow. Okay. 3, 2, 1. And there comes the quiz. One. 3, 2, 1. Oh.
A lot of wrong answers.
Wow.
The good one was Chewy, of course.
Chewy, of course. Okay, yeah. Next one. What was the name of the model Frank shot during the mobile shoot? Was that Lois, Nadine, Rosa, or Melissa? Oh, wow. That's nice. Cindy is going awesome. Okay, next. What phone is Frank using in that shoot? So in that mobile shoot?
With Lois.
With Lois. Is that my Huawei P30? the latest iPhone, the Sony Xperia, or a Samsung Galaxy? Ooh, that's a nice phone. Which one? Or is it that phone on the top? Oh,
good.
Okay, very well.
Awesome.
Oh, we have Ineke coming up. Yes, next. Okay. What is the main advantage of the mobile workflow? Is that work from every location, better apps, easier apps, or cheaper apps?
Seven answers.
Oh, wow. That's impressive.
Good, you paid attention. Oh, Cindy is hot.
Oh?
I see a flame.
Be careful. Can you import high-res files in Lightroom directly on the iPad? So watch out, directly. No, via the cloud, via card reader or drive, no. Yes, after copying them to the photo album. Do think about this before you press.
It's a trick question.
It's a little bit of a trick question. Because some other... whatever. Okay, it can be done via card reader. Now, normally, of course, it could be done via the photo album, but that's only when you do files, for example, on YouTube, because the files app actually butchers those files. But Lightroom can be direct.
So only one was right?
Yes, only one was right. You can do it via the cloud, but normally you can also do it high-res via the card reader.
I mean, only one player had it right.
Oh, can you rename files in Lightroom Mobile?
Yes or no?
Yes or no?
No or yes?
No or yes. Ooh,
six answers.
You can't do it. And that's one of the things that I don't like. Okay. Ooh, Cindy is losing. Leo is now on top. Ooh, Cindy, come on. Okay, next one. Can Lightroom work via auto import on the iPad? So watch out on the iPad. And the answer, of course, is yes. I don't do it on the iPad, but it can be done. It's just more limited.
Only two answers.
Yeah.
The rest is...
I think we're going too fast.
Oh, maybe they are kicked out. Yeah.
Okay. Can you sync Lightroom Mobile into Lightroom Classic automatically? Yes, via difficult workaround. No, you need Lightroom for that. No. Or yes, of course. And I hope nobody chooses the blue one. Oh. Okay, don't choose the blue one. Oh, one choose the blue. It's yes, of course. You need Lightroom for that. That's, of course, literally logical. So, go for next. Okay, and who's now on top? Leo. Oh, Cindy is climbing up again. So, next. Which filter is Frank missing in Photoshop on the iPad?
Did you tell it?
Yeah, oh, I did tell it.
Cindy lost connection.
Oh, no.
We had that too. I think everybody lost it because we only got three
answers. Add noise. Totally correct.
Yeah.
Okay, go for next.
Sorry, Cindy.
doesn't matter. She's still on top. Okay, next. Last question. Which accessory is essential for your iPad Pro, which Frank didn't buy and now regret? And I didn't tell you that, so you really have to guess this. If you hear weird noises, Chewy is really close to the microphone. And it's the backlit keyboard with trackpad. I really didn't like not buying that one. Okay, so let's see. We have on three. I don't see who's on three.
Oh, well, we don't weird. See any names.
Maybe it's because it's on white. But number one won. Number one won. Okay,
was it Leo, I guess?
I think Leo, yeah.
Oh, the runners-up are Ineke and Cindy.
Ah, cool.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Did you like it?
I hope you guys like that we also play a little bit of a game with you guys. So it's something new that we do, and I just hope that you like it. Now, we also planned on doing a portfolio review or doing some images in review. And I only got in one because we started pretty late with it. Let me see if I can draw it up really fast. Because I did something wrong. And let me see. Add a new one. Add from files. Let me start off a little commercial in between so we can find it up. Let's do this working with models.
Hey guys, welcome in the Netherlands, Amsterdam. This is my home country and my name is Frank Doroff. Working with models, that's what I love to do. That's where my main passion is. Working with models gives you the option to create something amazing. I try to really dig in deeper. And to dig in deeper, you have to make sure that your model is at ease. How do you pose your model? How do you style your model? How do you make sure that your image really tells that story? If you want to know more about working with models, check out my class on coaching and working with models on kelby1.com. Hey guys, welcome in the Netherlands, Amsterdam. This is my home country.
And of course, it was not the idea that you saw the video twice. So here we have Chewy, our wonder dog. Say hi.
Say hi.
Aww.
No.
No, he doesn't want to say hi. Okay, so I have the image here. So let me switch over. Okay. Now, overall, I really like the look of the shot. I like the lines. That looks really nice. I don't know what I would change, but I'm more somebody that doesn't like natural looking shots, so I would change probably a little bit. Let me play around with it, just give it a little bit more this. Go into color and let's go. I really love that color grading, I can't help myself. And oh, sorry, let's just, I think, a little bit more warm. Yes, midtones maybe. There you go. And highlights towards. Oh, this is nice. Look at this. That actually gives me another idea for the shadows. There we go. Okay. Before and after. And just give it a slight texture boost and clarity. And of course you have to do the skin then a little bit better. And a little bit of vignetting. And maybe play a little bit with curves to finish it off. And you see how powerful those curves are, right? It's absolutely awesome. Okay, before, after. I love the shot. I love the posing. I love the leading lines. I love the sky. This, with the hairs, this is a little... But you get that when you're using strobes outside and natural light. It will show you this. If there's a little bit of wind, that will actually go wrong. But that isn't a real bad thing. It's just something that catch my eyes. And I think there's a little bit too much hair in her face. I would take that out, probably. But that will be very difficult to do, or you have to spend a lot of time on it. But overall, I really like the shot. I like the clothing. It's awesome. So Raymond, very well done. The only thing I would change is just a little bit in colors. So overall, great. Okay, let me switch over back to the normal camera because I think we are at the end at the moment. Did you like it, Annemiek? Did you like the show? Did you like the Kahoot in the show?
Yeah, and I'm sorry I got interrupted. There was someone at the door.
Yeah.
With a large parcel I had to bring to our company. We are at home now, so it's struggling.
It is struggling.
And,
but hey, better safe than sorry.
Did you do the announcement of the lecture in Belgium?
No. We are doing a lecture very soon. And let me show you very quickly. Oh, I don't have audio there. Let me change audio to my microphone. One moment. You don't see what I'm doing now. It's one, two, one. Yes, there we go. Okay, one of the things that, of course, nowadays we can't teach any workshops, and this means that we are now doing actually stuff online. And you see that we can stream online, right? Like this kind of stuff. And we can even do photo shoots online. So I believe next year we're going to do a photo shoot for a photo club in Australia.
And I'm not sure it's going to be a photo shoot, but we'll definitely do a photo shoot for the photography show.
For the photography show in the UK.
Birmingham, UK.
Yes.
And we do a lecture for a photo club in Australia. So that's also really nice, but that's in September. So that's a long time ago, a long, far away.
It will take some time.
And
yes.
But this is January 13 in Belgium. It's on Zoom. And it's only $10. It's 2 hours.
Yeah, and the $10 goes directly to the photo club,
photo
so
club.
Not to us.
Yeah, not to us. And it's going to be awesome.
Yeah, it's the thing is, and if you are a member of a photo club and you're watching this or you want to do this, we are set up at the moment. We invested a lot of money to literally also have our home studio totally specced out for live streaming. So if I'm correct now, there were no hiccups anymore and no slowdowns or actually lags. So it should work all very nicely. We are adding that interactive element with Kahoot. So if you are in a photo club or whatever, we are really enthusiastic about this kind of stuff. So just email us and we can do a live stream for your photo club. Just have a big projector there and we can even have interaction with the viewers for the very simple reason. With Kahoot or via social media, we can just talk with you guys and answer questions. It's different from me being there, of course, but I think it's the best thing for now. So Chewy next, says, thank you so very much.
Next digital classroom is probably about January 20. We don't know yet. Could be a week later, but let's try.
And I think it's going to be because up until January 19, we are not allowed to do any workshops or any photo shoots. Instead, we actually have to stay. We don't have to stay in our homes, but it's wiser to stay in your home. So I don't know what we're going to do. We're probably going to do a portfolio review, just sending your images. And maybe a Q&A, sending your questions. What do you want to ask me? In between, what I'm going to do, and this is going to be a little bit of a hard promise, now that we have everything set up and we have different audio set up, I will start again with the guitar live streams on Twitch. So I'm not going to do that on YouTube. We're going to do that on Twitch. It's just me playing around with backing tracks and just explaining you guys what we do and showing different guitars.
Did you show the microphone?
No. And we have something else for the mobile workflow. And this is really interesting.
I'm going to make a video about it soon.
Yeah, we're going to make a video about this. But this is one of the things. And Boya actually sent this to us. And this is really, really cool. Now,
thank you, Boya.
Thank you. On your phone, you, of course, want external audio because the microphones in the phone are okay. But you don't want to work around with dongles, right? And you want a longer cable because, let's say, if can you walk the dog a little bit, Annemiek?
Yeah.
So, Annemiek says bye. So, when you are... Hey, did you bring your Christmas sweater, Annemiek?
Yeah.
Show your Christmas sweater. They didn't see that yet. Give it a little bit of a Christmas atmosphere, right? There you go. Awesome. De Foute Kersttrui. That's Dutch.
It's actually a snowman.
It's very nice.
Okay, I'll go walk the dog.
Go walk the dog for now. Okay, so one of the things, of course, you want external audio. And, well, this is a USB-C, believe it or not, a USB-C microphone, a Lavalier. But the thing is, it has a really long cable. Now, at first you might say, Frank, why do you need a long cable? Listen, when you do a vlog and you walk around with your phone, you, of course, want to have proper audio, right? Now, the only thing you have to do is make sure that this fits somewhere here and just work away the cable in your clothing. So don't leave it hanging like this, but just throw it away inside your clothing. And then a long cable really helps because now when you walk, I have this in my pocket of my coat. And as soon as I think, oh, I want to record something, the only thing I have to do is pick up my USB-C connector, plug it into my phone, wait a few seconds and now I have external audio. And I can just leave it here. As soon as I'm done with video, I just disconnect it and I just put it back in my pocket and I can walk around. So a USB-C microphone with a long cable, and as you can see here, the Boya has a really, really long cable. Highly recommend it. Otherwise, you are working with extension cords. And I promise you guys something else, and I hope I can figure out how to do this. Let me take camera 2. You didn't see camera 2 yet because we have another camera set up. I'm going to show you what we use at the moment for our live streaming. So this is my desk. This is where we normally record our music. And if I pick up this camera, let me see if it works. That's our RGB link. So we have a display on there and we have several cameras between which we can switch. As you can see now, we're using 3 HDMIs, but we can use 4. And, okay, there we go. Let's go back to our other camera. And the nice thing about this unit is that you can do picture in picture and it scales every single input. So we have a similar setup in our studio where we normally do the photo shoots. And that's way more expensive. It's a Roland mixer. It's literally a mixer panel for our audio. And we use one Magewell for my desktop and we use one Blackmagic for the cameras. Total about 1,500 to 2,000 euros. This one is 299 and does exactly the same thing. So If you are into live streaming, check it out. They are absolutely amazing. It's not sponsored. I literally pay for the device, so I did get it on test, but I'm keeping it, so I have to pay for it, which is a shame because it's really nice. But for $299, come on, guys, a scaler that does HDMI, scales every HDMI to 1080p, which you can literally feed into Zoom or Wirecast or OBS, whatever you want, it's absolutely a steal. Okay, that's it from my side. I hope you enjoyed this episode. Let me see. A lot of guys are seeing here. Good to see you again. Yes. Okay, that I don't miss any questions. Let me see. Awesome. Okay, from my side and from Anna Week, we would like to wish you all a very, very nice holidays. These holidays are gonna be terrible. Also for us, we have a very small family, so for us a lot of things don't really change, because when we visit my parents, it's always Anna-Week, Brian and me, so, and the dog. So for us it doesn't change, but I know a lot of you guys out there are literally in despair, because you can only, in the Netherlands at least, we can only have 3 people at home with Christmas, 2 normally, 3 with Christmas. But do remember what we do it for. And it's a very simple saying, better 6 feet apart than 6 feet under, right? And in the Netherlands, we like to say, a quick test is free, your grandparents aren't. So let's make sure that we keep our workers that are actually in our healthcare working. And let's just stay at home and don't do any crazy stuff like throwing fireworks at test streets and disconnecting cables that the test street doesn't work. What's going on in your mind? This is a serious business. Just make sure that you don't get sick and don't infect other people. And if you do that, you can do whatever you want. You can go outside, you can go wherever you want. Just keep your distance. Don't do anything stupid, because that's why we are in these lockdowns, because people just don't want to keep their distance. And we have to make sure our healthcare keeps working. So for all the guys in healthcare, you guys rock. You are the real heroes of this whole crisis. And the only thing we have to do is stay at home. We don't have to do anything. Watch live streams. Watch my YouTube channel. Buy some instructional videos. Let me do a little cool tip for you guys. If you now go to www.frankdorff.com/videos and you order whichever video you want, 50% off, just because of the whole crisis and because a lot of people are at home. We're going to extend our Black Friday deal. We just made a code again. I'm losing money on most of the videos, but I don't care. I just want you guys to have fun with the videos. So 50% off on all the videos and also all the presets. Let's do also the presets. So let's do 50% of everything. So we're going to change that also for the presets. So whatever you order via this link and the presets, it's all for 50% off. So you can get presets for €5. So that's gonna hurt. Anyway, okay, that's it. I would like to thank you so very much for watching. Leave comments below. And of course, I will see you next time in a live stream. Awesome, guys.